Very good day to one another. So today's session is on fluoride devices, which is actually part of the topics fluoride. This comes under fluorides alone, which is a topically applied, self-applied type of fluoride application. So the most commonly evaluated fluoride devices are sodium fluoride, stannous fluoride, and more recently sodium monofluorophosphates and amine fluoride are also being used. The most commonly involved ingredient in a fluoride enterprises are sodium fluoride, stannous fluoride. Recently, there is currently, if you check all the toothpaste, you can see this component called sodium monofluorophosphate and amine fluoride. So, sodium fluoride, stannous fluoride are enterprises, and amine fluoride, monofluorophosphate are the common ingredients which is found in enterprises. The components, chemical formula, and functions of the enterprises should be thoroughly read. Components are sodium fluoride, which is sodium fluoride or sodium monofluorophosphate, the cardiostatic agents which is used in the enterprise. Then the humectants commonly used is phosphate sorbitol, abrasives like silica, humectant, for example, glycerin is used. Then a detergent agent, sodium lauryl sulfate, vehicle is water, buffer is disodium phosphate, saccharin will be the sweetener. Then some flavoring agents like spearmint oil or menthol will be added. Opacifiers like titanium dioxide, binders like xanthan gum or calcium carrageenan, carbomer. Colors can vary like brilliant blue or other. If they recommend some other colors, it can change accordingly. And one of the preservatives which is used is sodium benzoate. So this is something you should learn from fluoride enterprises. It's ingredients of composition, then if possible, the chemical formula and its function. So basically, components and its function should be read. The recommendation for use of fluoride enterprises are ages below 4 years. Usually, we don't recommend because they don't fit properly once, or there are chances of them ingesting the toothpaste. So from 4 to 6 years, once daily with fluoride paste, twice without paste is recommended. From 6 to 10 years, twice daily with fluoride paste and once without paste. And about 10 years, twice daily with fluoride paste. So what is the right amount of fluoride toothpaste recommended for age groups? Like children under the age 3, it should be around, as you can see in this picture, it should be around rice grain size amount. Approximately 0.125 grams, and children aged 3 to 6 plus age, it should be a pea size amount, which is around 0.25 grams. And on average, most children use as much as 8 times the recommended dose. So, you are supposed to, when you are giving oral hygiene instructions, this is something which you should stress on to when you are giving some instructions about using toothpaste in their day to day life. Next is fluoride toxicity. So before understanding fluoride toxicity, you should know something called as probable toxic dose. This is defined threshold dose that could cause serious or life-threatening systemic signs and symptoms. So this is the maximum amount a person can tolerate. So safely tolerated dose is around 8 milligram to 16 milligram per kilogram body weight, and the toxic dose will range from around 16 milligram to 32 milligram per kilogram body weight. The lethal dose, which might even kill the individual, is around 32 milligram to 64 milligram per kilogram body weight. So what is acute toxicity? Acute toxicity is nothing but ingestion of large dose of fluoride at one time. So suddenly, this is something which can happen accidentally also. So the factors affecting acute toxicity are bioavailability, route of administration, age of the child, because the absorption rate will depend on the kilogram body weight of the individual, then the rate of absorption and the acid base status of the individual. So the signs and symptoms of acute toxicity are, initially they'll be having nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, sudden diarrhea will be there, excess salivation and mucosal discharge. General weakness and carpopedal spasm will be there, weak thready pulse, fall in blood pressure, depression of respiratory centers, decreased plasma calcium level, because all these calcium will get binded with the fluoride when you get ingested, increased potassium level, cardiac arrhythmia, coma, and finally death. So how we manage this acute or the sudden, if a patient suddenly ingests a lethal dose or a very high amount of fluoride. So immediately what you're supposed to do is aim at reducing fluoride absorption. So first and foremost is to reduce the fluoride absorption which is happening in the body. That is by inducing vomiting, or you can replace the fluid replacement, monitoring levels of plasma calcium and potassium. That is how you will know the level of absorption the child is having. So less than 5 mg/kg full fluoride ingestion, you can give milk them off and even induce vomiting. So if it's more than 5 mg/kg, give milk, you can induce vomiting. 5% calcium gluconate, which helps in the binding of the fluoride, then definitely the child or the person should be hospitalized. If it's more than 15 mg/kg, then induce vomiting. Hospitalization is a must. Cardiac monitoring, that is a peaking of T wave or prolonged QT interval, will be noticed in such patients. Slow administration, 10% calcium gluconate. This is something which is an agent which will reverse the process. Then the maintain urinary output, supportive measures for the shock should be taken care. If the consumption is more than 15 mg/kg. So what do you mean by chronic toxicity? Chronic toxicity, we can explain it as under dental fluorosis and skeletal fluorosis. Chronic toxicity means the individual is getting exposed to fluoride for a very long period of time. It's not just a sudden ingestion. Yeah, there is no sudden ingestion. Like for a long period of time, the individual has already got exposed to high level of fluoride, and which might induce something called as dental fluorosis and skeletal fluorosis. So dental fluorosis, it is caused by successive exposure to high concentration of fluoride during tooth development, leading to enamel with lower mineral content and increased porosity. So the etiopathogenesis are, there is direct inhibitory effect on enzymatic action of amyloblasts, leading to defective matrix formation and subsequent hypomineralization. So the extent of fluorosis can be evaluated by using Dean's fluorosis index. So something which was described by Trentley H. Dean in 1934, then there have been modifications of this Dean's index. So there will be examination of all tooth surfaces, which was done in a good natural light with the child seated facing window. So the rating 0 means it's normal, where the characteristics should be. The enamel shows the usual translucency. The surface is smooth, shiny, usually of a pale, creamy white to gray white color. Then the rating will be 0.5. That is, the enamel shows slight aberrations ranging from a few white flecks to occasional white spots. So it will look like white spot lesion. Then rating 1 will be very mild. Here the characteristics will be small, opaque, paper white area scattered irregularly over the tooth, but not involving more than 25% of the tooth surface. Rating 2 will be mild, opaque, paper white areas, that is more extensive, involving more than 25%, but less than 50%. Rating 3 will be, is considered as moderate. All enamel surfaces are affected and also shows attrition. 4 will be severe. All enamel surfaces are affected and hyperplasia is so marked that general form of tooth is affected. Discrete or confluent pitting and brown stains. Here it does not look white. It will be more like a brown stain, as it was introduced in the history, like a Colorado stain. Then it is a basic characteristic feature of fluorosis in a severe condition. And skeletal fluorosis, or otherwise known as osteofluorosis, the clinical features are increase. There will be increase in bone density, change in bone contour, irregular periosteal growth, spinal column, and the pelvis shows roughening and blurring of the trabecular, and it is definitely noticed in the radiographs also. So bone appears as marble white shadow and the configuration is woolly. The cortex of long bone is thick and dense and the medullary cavity is diminished. And ligamental and tendon calcification with vague pains in joints are one of the most common symptoms in skeletal fluorosis. There will be stiffness and limitations of joint movement because of these calcification, immobilizing the patient, and it is basically known as crippling fluorosis. So there is a classification which was given by Teotia clinical classification, which is classified to three: mild, moderate, and severe. Mild is basically generalized bone and joint pains will be there. Moderate, mild symptoms with stiffness, rigidity, and restricted movement of spine and joints. Severe symptoms of moderate fluorosis along with flexion, deformities of spine, hips and knees, genuvalgum, genuvarum, bowing and rotational deformities of leg, neurological complications, crippling and bedridden state. So these are the severe, in severe fluorosis exposure, these are the most common symptoms which you can see. Radiologically, what you can, the differences which you can see in mild condition is there will be osteosclerosis. In moderate condition, signs of mild fluorosis along with periosteal bone formation, calcification of interosseous membrane will be present. Even that will be there in the ligaments and muscular attachment, capsules and tendons. There will be calcific lesions. Severe condition, signs of moderate fluorosis with which is associated with metabolic bone disease like rickets, non-osteomalacia, osteoporosis, then exostosis and osteophytosis will be present. Next is defluoridation. Defluoridation techniques are broadly classified into four categories. It can be adsorption technique, it can be done by ion exchange technique, precipitation techniques, and other techniques which include electrochemical defluoridation and reverse osmosis. So one of the most famous, which is practiced in India, explained by Navlaki in 1974, is Nalagonda technique. This involved the addition of three readily available chemicals, that are sodium aluminate or lime, otherwise known as a bleaching powder, and filler alum is also added to this fluoridate water in the same sequence, which lead to a process known as flocculation. Then you'll do a sedimentation process and finally a filtration. So major advantages of Nalgonda techniques are there is no regeneration of media, no handling of caustic acids and alkalis. Readily available chemicals are used in this process, adaptable to domestic usage, simplicity in design, construction and maintenance. There is only very little wastage of water and needs minimal mechanical and electrical equipments for proceeding with the Nalgonda technique. And some of the disadvantages are desalinization may be necessary in this process. And hardness of the raw water is in the range of 200 milligrams per liter to 600 milligram requires, which requires precipitation softening. So basically, once defluoridation is done, the water becomes hard. Then the generation of higher quantity of sludging compared to electromechanical defluoridation technique. So there will be sludge formation. Then large amount of alum is needed to remove the fluoride. Some of the modifications are, they changed with the ingredients which they have used. That is, one is polyaluminium chloride. It is evident that for higher concentration of fluoride, the removal efficiency of fluoride is higher with polyaluminium chloride. So they compared it with alum, and by replacing PAC with that, they found that the removal efficiency was better for polyaluminium chloride. And polyaluminium hydroxysulfate is another compound. It is found to require less flocculation time and setting time. So when compared to alum, these two methods were better and it has got higher efficiency. So that is all. Thank you. Further questions and doubts can be discussed in the online sessions if you're having, or during the clinical posting times. So in case if there is anything which I've missed out, you can point it out. And so the session is ended. Today's fluoride session is ended by this video. So in case if there is anything more to be discussed, we will be discussing in the online sessions or clinical postings. Thank you.